Hi, this is Vignesh from BNMU. Today we are going to see about brachial plexus. So what is plexus? Plexus is nothing but branching of network of vessels or nerves. So when we take out the cross section of spinal cord, you can see the posterior division and the anterior division, or posterior rami and anterior rami. From the anterior rami, the brachial plexus is formed. So the brachial plexus is formed by union of anterior division of lower four cervical nerves, which is C5 to C8, and the greater part of anterior primary division of first dorsal nerve, which is a T1. So the connection between C5 to T1, okay, and the brachial plexus, which lies on scalenus medius muscle and external to the outer border of scalenus anticus. So the brachial plexus, which lies on scalenus medius muscle and external to the outer border of scalenus anticus, so it is exactly the anterior part of neck, exactly here, so which form the three trunks. So this four cervical nerves and the one dorsal nerves, C5 to T1, we call it as roots. So these roots combine and form three trunks. So now we see. Told lower four cervical nerves from C5, C6, C7, C8 and T1. So this we call it as roots. So the C5 and C6, which form upper trunk, and the C7, which forms the middle trunk, and the C8, which forms the lower trunk. So from this trunk, which is divided into two divisions, so we call it as, this one is anterior division and posterior division, okay. These are called as roots. These roots, which forms the trunks, and these three trunks, which forms divisions, means anterior division and the posterior division. So all of this posterior division, all of the divisions from upper trunk, middle trunk and lower trunk, which make the posterior cord, and the anterior division of upper and middle trunk, which forms lateral cord, and the lower trunk of anterior division, which make middle cord. Okay, this is posterior cord, this is lateral cord, this is medial cord. So first, these are called roots. So these are called roots. These roots make three trunks. These are trunk. One is upper trunk, one is middle trunk, and one is lower trunk. This trunk, which divided into divisions, these are called divisions one is anterior division, one is posterior division. So these two divisions which make three chords. So the posterior division of upper trunk, middle trunk and lower trunk, which combine and form the posterior chord, and the upper and middle trunk which combine and form the lateral chord, and the anterior division of lower trunk which form medial chord. So there is a three chords: posterior chord, lateral chord and middle chord. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 roots which form three trunks: upper trunk, middle trunk and lower trunk. Three trunks. These three trunks form divisions. This is two divisions. These two divisions which gives the chords, which is three chords: posterior chord, lateral chord and medial chord. These three chords make branches. So after that we'll see the branches. What are the branches? So from the lower four cervical nerves or cervical segments, from C5 to C8, and one dorsal nerve which is T1, from the T1 segment we call it as roots. These five roots which make three trunks by combination of C5 and C6 which form upper trunk, the C7 which make middle trunk, C5 and T1 which join and make lower trunk. These trunks which form two divisions, which forms divisions, and the division is anterior and posterior division. So anterior division, posterior division, anterior division, posterior division, anterior division, posterior division, anterior division, posterior division, anterior division, posterior division. So this division which make chords, the posterior division of upper trunk, middle trunk and lower trunk which make the posterior chord, by the anterior division of upper and middle trunk which make lateral chord, anterior division of lower trunk which make middle chord. So this chord is named or labeled by the help of axillary artery. So this posterior, lateral or medial chord which named by the upon by the axillary artery. Now I'll show how it's named, so can easily find out how it's named. Assume this axillary artery. Okay. Behind of axillary artery, behind of axillary artery, you can find posterior chord. The outer side of axillary artery, you can find lateral chord. The inner side of axillary artery, you can find medial chord. So behind of axillary artery, the posterior chord is passing through. The outer side of axillary artery, the lateral chord is passing through. And the inner side of axillary artery, the medial chord is passes through. So upon the axillary artery, this chord is named. So now we go through the branches. What are the branches? So we'll write that. Lateral chord, medial chord and the posterior chord. I'm going to see the branches. So I'm going to give you the mnemonic. For the lateral chord, LML for medial cord, for the medial cord, this MUM. Mostly medical men use morphine. For the posterior cord, it is stars. Okay. So, from the lateral cord, what are the branches? For L, which is lateral pectoral nerve or anterior thoracic nerve. So you can call it as anterior thoracic nerve or a lateral pectoral nerve. So which innervate the pectoral muscle. And then M, which is musculocutaneous nerve. The third one, which is lateral root of median nerve. Okay. And then medial cord, the first one, which is M, which is medial pectoral nerve or branch of anterior thoracic nerve. And the second one is medial cutaneous root of arm. The third one, medial cutaneous root of forearm. And then U, which is ulnar nerve, which supplies forearm, arm and hands. And the fifth one, which is medial root of medial nerve. Medial root of medial nerve. So and then the posterior cord, which is stars. The first one, yes, which is subscapularis nerve, which is the upper part, the upper subscapularis nerve. The second one, which is thoracodorsal nerve. This thoracodorsal nerve, also called it as middle subscapularis nerve. And then the third one, which is axillary nerve or circumflex nerve, or you can call it as axillary circumflex nerve or circumflex axillary nerve. And then or, which is radial nerve. Now, and then fifth one is a lower subscapularis nerve. Subscapularis nerve, the lower part. So these are the branches which are given by the cords. First of all, the lateral cord, which gives three branches: the lateral pectoral nerve or anterior thoracic nerve, and then the musculocutaneous nerve. The lateral root of median nerve. The posterior cord, which gives five branches: medial pectoral nerve, medial cutaneous root of arm, medial cutaneous root of forearm, ulnar nerve, medial root of medial nerve. The posterior cord, upper subscapularis nerve, thoracodorsal nerve, which is a middle subscapularis nerve, and then axillary nerve or a circumflex nerve or circumflex axillary nerve, and then radial nerve, and then subscapularis nerve, so lower subscapularis nerve. So now I'm going to write according to the region, the nerves which is supplies according to the regions like chest, shoulders and arms. So we'll see what are the nerves which supply the regions. chest, shoulders, and the hands. So these are the nerve supplies according to the region, which is divided into below clavicle and above clavicle. In below clavicle, which is innervate the three areas, which is chest, shoulder, arm, hand, and forearm areas. For the chest, which is innervated by anterior thoracic nerve. For shoulders, which is innervated by subscapular nerve and circumflex nerve. For hand, arm, and forearm, which is innervated by musculocutaneous nerve. And we have a cutaneous branch, which is internal and the external branch. And then median nerve, ulnar nerve, and musculospinal nerve, which is a branch of internal cutaneous nerve. So musculospinal nerve, which is a branch from the internal cutaneous nerve. And in the above clavicle, we have a communicating branch, muscular branch, posterior thoracic nerve, and subscapular nerve. The communicating branch, which communicate with phrenic nerve. So in the segment of C5 and C6. In the segment, it will communicate with the phrenic nerve, and in the muscular branch, which innervate the longus coli muscles, subclavius muscle, rhomboideus muscle, scalenus muscles, and the posterior thoracic nerve, which arises from C5, C6, and C7, which innervate the serratus magnus nerve, serratus magnus muscle, sorry, and then subscapular nerve, which arises from the segment of C5, C6, which innervate the supraspinatus muscle, the shoulder joint. What are the structures which present in the shoulder joint, and then the infraspinatus muscle. So these are the nerve supplies according to the region, below clavicle and above clavicle. So now we will see what are the clinical aspects in the brachial plexus. So mainly we have Herpes palsy, and then we have Klumke's palsy. So I will show you. So mainly, when we have injury to the brachial plexus, so it leads to two clinical aspects. One is Herpes palsy, and one more is Klumke's palsy. In Herpes palsy, if you have damage to the C5 and C6 segment, so if you have damage to the roots or a damage to the trunk, it lead to weakened or lesser movement in particular area. So in that particular area, the muscular movement is less and weaker movement. So in the area, the muscle which is weakened or lesser movement. So the muscle which affect in the Herpes palsy are supraspinator muscles, infraspinator muscles, biceps muscle, and brachialis muscles. So these are the muscles which weakened or lesser movement in the Herpes palsy. So the patient will appear the supination the supination position of the forearm, and then you can see the abduction and the flexion in the shoulder, supination in the forearm. The patient will appear there, you can see the supination of the forearm, the flexion and abduction at the shoulders. When we move to the Klumke's palsy, mainly when we have injury to the T1 segment, it leads to Klumke's palsy, or sometimes with the C8, when you have a junction, the trunk or root, if you have injury in the trunk, so C8 and T1, it is injured or damaged, it leads to the damage of ulnar and median nerve. So the ulnar and median nerve, which supplies the flexor muscles in the forearm, those muscles which may be weakened or lesser movement. So the patient will appear as claw shaped appearance or claw hand appearance. So it is like this claw appearance. In claw appearance, the metacarpophalangeal joint, which is hyperextended. This metacarpophalangeal joint is hyperextended, and then the IP, intra or interphalangeal joint, is flexion. The flexion of interphalangeal joints, hyperextension of metacarpophalangeal joints. So extended and then flexion in the intraphalangeal joints. So these are the two important clinical aspects. In Hirps palsy, the patient will appear as supination of forearm, abduction and flexion at a shoulder. In Klumke's palsy, the patient will show the claw hand appearance. So there is hyperextended metacarpophalangeal joints, flexion in the interphalangeal joints. So thanks for watching. We'll continue to some other topics and some other videos. Thanks.